Good morning and welcome to the second session of the State Library of New South Wales four-part webinar series on the Historical Land Records Viewer Database. My name's Wendy and I'm a librarian here at the State Library. I'd first like to acknowledge the traditional owners of country throughout New South Wales and Australia and recognise their ongoing connection to land, waters and culture. And we pay our respects to their elders, past, present and emerging. In the first session, my colleague Glenda introduced you to the HLRV and the sort of documents that you will find on this database. She also took you through the search functions, how to set up a search, how to interpret the results, and how to make the most of the image viewer. And she also gave you an historical survey of land management in New South Wales, including an overview of the three land titling systems in New South Wales, that is Crown Land, Old System Title, and Torrens Title. And today I'm going to take you through the Old System Title deed documents that you can find on the HLRV. Or rather, I should qualify that by saying I'm going to focus on the two major data sets because we don't have time to cover everything. These are very large data sets and certainly a very good starting point for if you're searching for old system land. And the first one is the Register of Land Grants and Leases, sometimes known as the Grant Register. And this covers early Crown land grants from 1792 right through to 1862. The other one is the General Register of Deeds, which covers land that was privately transacted between individuals from 1825 right up to 1992 on the HLRV. So this really is very much a whirlwind introduction. We don't have time for questions, but hopefully your questions will be answered in the course of the next half an hour or so. And we've also included a list of tips for finding title deed numbers, a list of resources and guides that are going to help you with your land research, and a step-by-step for the demonstration that I'm going to show you today for the HLRV for these two documents. And I'd also recommend the mini webinar series that have been created by our chums out at State Archives. There's four mini webinars pertaining to land in particular, and these would be very useful to help you with your land research on the HLRV and for documents held out at State Archives. If you still have questions, by all means, you can send us an inquiry through our Ask a Librarian service. We can't undertake your research for you, but we will be able to provide you with some guidance if you're stuck or where to go, where your next steps will be. So let's have a look at the old system in a little more detail before I go on to demonstrate searching on the HLRV for old system documents. So just a couple of points about old system. So from the registration of the first grant of Crown land in February 1792, right through until 1862, land ownership in New South Wales was based on the old English common law system. It's now known as the old system, although at the time in New South Wales, it was referred to as common law. In its perfect form, old system is a chain of evidence or a chain of title deeds. And ideally, owners will have all those documents leading back to the original grant. But the old system title had a lot of problems associated with it, which I'll brush on shortly. And it was replaced in 1862 by the Torrens titling system, which brought a number of benefits and also solved a lot of problems with old system. The Register of Land Grants and Leases ran until 1862, but that doesn't mean that Crown grants stopped in 1862. It just meant that thereafter they were subject to the Real Properties Act of 1862, which regulated the Torrens title system. On the other hand, old system land that was held privately wasn't automatically transferred to Torrens title. It could be converted through a process known as a primary application, but this involved the pretty onerous task of gathering all the documentary evidence to prove that the title was good. This was, of course, impossible for some parcels of land and very difficult for many other parcels of land, and consequently, land remained in the old system for many years. And that's why the General Register of Deeds has such a long tail on it of 170 years in the HLRV. On your screen, you'll see a map of the 141 counties of New South Wales. And the area in pink is really the area where old system title applies. These are known as the 19 counties and represent what was known as the limits of location. So these were established in the 1820s. And beyond those limits of location, it was illegal to settle. Of course, people did, and they were known as squatters. So the pink counties really refer to land that stretches from Batemans Bay in the south right through to Kempsey in the north and Wellington in the west. But there are some exceptions. And so, for example, there's a parcel of land up near Grafton. There's an area in the Grafton area that covers old system, that is was included in old system. There's land out at Dubbo. And also in the 1840s, the squatters won the right to lease their land, and these leases were administered in the old system. And you'll find these leases in the Grants Register. Also, other areas of Australia that were once part of the colony of New South Wales, such as Queensland and Norfolk Island, were also administered by old system title. And in the Grants Register, you will find grants for parcels of land in this area. You won't find any privately transacted land, as far as I can work out, or as far as I've been able to verify, I should say, in the General Register of Deeds. You will find them in the indexes, but when you have a look at those deeds, when you look for those deeds in the General Register, you'll find that they have been extracted and presumably sent to the appropriate authorities in those other states. So let's take a look at a sample from the Grant Register. And before I go on to discuss this, I do want to just flag that by the term grant, we sometimes assume that means free. All it really means is the transfer of land from the Crown to a private individual, which is often referred to as alienation from the Crown. So grants weren't necessarily free. And in the Grant Register, you'll find, apart from free grants, you will find conditional grants, you'll find purchases and conditional purchases, and also leases as well. So let's take a closer look at an example. And this is for land that was granted to an emancipated convict called Cornelius Regan in 1823, and it was for land at Bringelly, which is in toward the west of Sydney. It's now part of Sydney, but at that time would have been rural land. And it was granted in 1823. Its reference number is serial 17, page 10. And that simply means it was a volume 17, page 10. And in the parlance of HLRV, that is its attribute, and this will become more significant later on. So let's take a look at what you'll find in these documents. So in the first paragraph, it shows that the governor has the authority to grant land, and that will include certain conditions. And I've also highlighted in red as well, this annotation. Now, oftentimes in the documents on the HLRV, you'll find there's little pencil annotations. It's well worth taking a note of all of these because sometimes these can be really relevant to the research that you're undertaking. So in this instance, for example, sometime after 1862, this parcel of land was converted through that primary application process that I mentioned. And this is the application number. And in fact, my colleague Michael in the next session is going to be taking you through what primary application documents are available on the HLRV. The primary applications themselves are held at state archives, but the HLRV does have search books and primary application search books and search sketchbooks on the HLRV, which will provide a wealth of information on the history of that ownership of that parcel of land. In the next paragraph, it mentions the grantee and the size of the grant. So he's been granted 60 acres and the location, which is generally expressed as a county and a parish. So in this case, though, it is the County of Cumberland and the District of Bringelly, because parishes hadn't yet been established at this early stage. It then goes on to provide a written description of the parcel of land and its location and dimensions and boundaries. And this is known as the meets and bounds, and it's expressed here as, for example, bounded on the north side by Hills Farm and 21 chains, 70 links of Wellings Farm bearing west, and so on and so forth. And sometimes these meets and bounds can also provide geographical information as well, geographical features. The next paragraph are the specific conditions of Cornelius Regan's grant. And there's quite a few of them. For example, he has to cultivate 16 of those 60 acres. He has to live on the land for 5 years, and he can't sell the land for the first 5 years. And if all of these conditions aren't met, then the grant can be deemed null and void. And then it's just signed and dated on behalf of the governor. So on the other hand, old system title deeds document the transfer of land between private individuals. And as I mentioned, the old system required owners to hang on to any documentary evidence that proved that the title was good. So that might include deeds, mortgages, leases, even wills and marriage certificates. Now, this was problematic because, of course, they could be lost or destroyed. And there were no standards for old system title deeds. And so they were as varied as the lawyers that drew them up. And they weren't all necessarily watertight. So all of this combined led to a lot of arguments over land. And there was a lot of court cases over land ownership and land boundaries. In order to give landholders some confidence, the government established a register as early as 1802. Now, it also includes land grants as far back as land title deeds as far back as 1794. And whilst it wasn't compulsory to register, it certainly gave landowners some surety. It also, the old Register 1-9 also includes other legal instruments as well. So it's a really interesting survey of colonial life in that time period. Now, it's not on the HLRV. It's on CD-ROM. We hold it in our Family History Service here on site at the State Library. It's also held out at State Archives, and Trove lists the holding libraries as well. It wasn't compulsory to register on the old Register 1-9, and it was replaced in 1825 by the General Register of Deeds. Once again, also not compulsory to register here, although there was considerable pressure to do so. Now, I'm going to take you through a typical example of a deed. And this is a deed for land that was sold at Paddington in 1862 between Thomas Veitch, the vendor, and James Stockbridge. And its reference number or attribute is Book 79, number 661. So let's go through this document here. And the very first line presents a regular problem that we have with deeds in the General Register of Deeds. And that is that the number has been inverted. So if you find a number related to a deed and you then search the HLRV, you must always put the book number in first and then the number. So sometimes they're written, it's written as 661 and then book 79. If you can't find what you're looking for, try inverting those numbers. On the right, it just simply tells us that it's a conveyance, which is a transfer of land, which is just one of the types of deeds that you'll find in the general register. The next paragraph talks about the parties to the deed. That is Thomas Veitch, who lives at Parramatta. He's a mason on the first part, or that is the vendor. And on the second part, or the purchaser, is James Stockbridge, who lives at Upper Paddington, and he's a carter, and he gives the date of the deed. The next refers to the prior transfers and owners of this parcel of land, really useful for providing the names. So we've got a William Wallace and a Charles Scott and a Henry Robertson. And unfortunately, it doesn't provide the title deed numbers for those transactions, but at least it provides us with the names, which we can then use to search the indexes that are available on the HLRV. In the next part, it talks about the intention of the deed, which in this case is the absolute sale to him of the piece or parcel of land hereinafter described and the inheritance thereof in fee simple, in possession free from encumbrances. In other words, it's freehold land that is held in perpetuity. And it also talks about the amount paid. Then it goes on to talk about the meets and bounds. It provides a lot number, or in this case, it's two lots, lots 17 and 18 of block E in a named subdivision. So that's the Wallace and Scott subdivision. And then it goes on to provide a written description of that parcel of land, including listing the neighbours Henry Baker and Henry Pickering. Now, all this information in here can then be used to search for documents in the HLRV. And just think laterally about the sort of information that you find here. So for example, it refers to the Wallace and Scott subdivision. Now, we have a lot of subdivision plans for parcels of land in Sydney and New South Wales. Our set for Sydney has been fully digitised and is available on our website through our maps research guide and through our catalogue. And you might find a reference to the Wallace and Scott subdivision on our website. So just think laterally about the sort of information that you'll find in these general register of deeds. Not everything is on the HLRV, and a lot of the documents that it refers to will require a trip out or at least an inquiry with the state archives. I also want to flag there's a great variety of documents in the general register. And the one, as two examples here, the one on the left is for land sold in 1975, and it very conveniently lists a schedule of all the title deed numbers going back to 1915. The title deed on the right has been annotated with a future title deed number, and I know that because it's described as vol and then a number and then fol, so a vol fol. And I know that that is the way that Torrens title deed numbers are expressed, and that means that it's been through the primary application process. Okay, so of course, the key to searching these documents really is the title deed and the grant numbers. So there's a lot of sources, if you don't have these details, that can help you. And I'm just going to take you through some of these now. And it also depending on what you're researching, whether you're researching your own property or whether you're researching an ancestor's property, will affect the sort of information that you already know. So you might know the names, but you might not know the location. Or you might know the location, but not the names or the dates or the deed numbers. So here's some sources. So for example, the Vendors Index provides a book and a number, but it also can be heavily annotated. So these are indexes that appear on the HLRV, can be heavily annotated with other title deed numbers. The primary application search books, which Michael will be taking you through in the next session, are also full of old title deed numbers or prior title deed numbers and names of owners. If you have the Torrens title deed number, the Volfol number, you can have a look for that on the HLRV. And in the first paragraph, it will give you the original grantee and the date of the grant. Ancestry has a data set of land grants. So all the information is available on Ancestry, but I find that the grant register is much easier to read and is a nice, neat document that can actually be printed, is one of the documents that you will be allowed to print off on the HLRV. So for example, I looked up Cornelius Regan and it told me that the date of the grant was 1823. It also, however, gave me a reference number of 1310. Now this doesn't match what we found in the HLRV. However, these numbers were changed over the years, and very happily, the Land Registry Services provides an information sheet on their website for these volume number changes. So you can see down here that volume 13 has been converted to volume 17, and that marries up with what we know from the HLRV. Parish maps are a mine of information because, as Glenda noted, they're really a visual index into land management in New South Wales. They can provide the grantee name, the portion number, and sometimes the grant date. If you can't find what you're looking for on one parish map, try other editions. And once again, I recommend that mini webinar series created by State Archives. That's really a great source for how to read parish maps. State Archives themselves also provide indexes to land on their website. Jeff Cannon has produced a series of books starting with the title, The First Title Holders in the County of... There's 14 counties covered in those early 19 counties. And these are really useful, especially if you don't know the parish in which the person had land. So sometimes a county can have numerous parishes. So these books allow you to search right across the one county in one alphabetical index. It'll provide you with, generally speaking, with a portion number, a grant date, and sometimes the grant or title number. Think laterally about where else you might find these numbers. So for example, in wills and deceased estate records held out at state archives. And also, councils will hold details about parcels of land in their council area, of course. There are brief information sheets available on the Land Registry Services. And if you go into research and then historical records online, you'll find them there. There is a link in the handout we're sending you. And this is where I found those grant volume number conversion chart, that grant volume number conversion chart as well. The Land Registry Services also has really detailed search guides. I think there's four of them. And in this, for Old System, there's the Old System Information and Search Guide, and there's also the Maps and Plans Search Guide. And these are invaluable because they provide you with all sorts of details, such as lists of all the acronyms and what they mean in all the documents and the maps and the plans that you'll find on the HLRV. Also glossaries of terms, and also how to read maps, plans and title deeds as well. I'd say they're almost essential guides if you want to progress your land research. Terry Cass has produced a great guide for searching for Crown land held out at, for all the records held out at State Archives. And of course, State Archives themselves have a number of really useful research guides for land. So now I'm going to demonstrate to you how to find these documents on the HLRV. So just bear with me as I switch over to the website. And here it is here. So I'm going to demonstrate to you how to find these two documents. So how to find Regan's grant and how to find the Veitch's sale of land to James Stockbridge here on the HLRV. So when you first go into the HLRV, You're given a set of terms and conditions, have a read of those and then accept them. And you'll be taken to the search page. So as Glenda took you through it, this is where you establish your search here. This is where you then put in your specific attribute for the document you're searching. And then this is where you'll get your results. So let's start off with the search page here. We're looking for old system records. So I'm going to click on the dropdown and we've got a choice of four here. We need to start by searching the old system indexes. So I'm going to click on the dropdown next to that. And we're absolutely spoiled for choice here. We've got a number of options here. Your eye might fall on the grant register index, but this is the index of pardons. And this one is simply a supplementary index. So just be a little bit careful there. The grant register actually falls in here in the old system grant indexes. So in the dropdown there, you'll find that there are four indexes. You can click on this box to search all four, but we're just going to search the grant index, the main grant index here. Click on that one. And now we set up our attribute. And in the search by box, we search by the surname initial. So we're looking for Regan. So I'm going to enter R for Regan and search. And we get 12 results. In other words, there's 12 indexes for grantees that cover, that are in the grant register. And we're going to look for the index that covers the 1820s. Here it is here. It's a 10-page index. So I'm going to click on that. And you can see here, before we get into the index, there's a jump to image. Sometimes these indexes have hundreds of pages. So you can use this to search through rather than just having to page through one page at a time. You can use this to then scan down to the jump in to an index at a particular point. So I'll just, reduce the size of that. Now I happen to know, I should mention the indexes, as Glenda mentioned, are not always in strict alphabetical order. Sometimes the first names aren't in alphabetical order and sometimes even the surnames. So just look carefully when you're searching through these indexes. Let's go to page three because Regan, I happen to know, appears on page three. Here he is here, Cornelius Regan. His land is at Bringelly. We've got 60 acres. So that's what we're looking for. And you can see here the serial number and the page number is 17 and 10. We just click on X now out of the image viewer. If you click on the back button, that will throw you right out of the HLRV. So you'll just have to get used to it, used to clicking on the X. A few early mistakes will cure you of that pretty quickly. Now we go in and now we've got the attribute and we'll then need to search for the grant itself. I always recommend that you clear your searches on the database because otherwise you may get too many results, not enough results, or the wrong result. So you can just do that by clicking on the icon up here. And we've got a nice clean slate. We'll go back into old system records. Click on the dropdown next to old system registers, and then we click on the grant register. We click on attribute, and in the search by dropdown, we've got a number of attributes, a number of ways that grants are expressed. Most of them are as a serial and page number. Sometimes you'll just get a page number, so then you have to find out in the index, it might just give you a page number. So then you have to find other means of identifying what date that grant might have appeared in, and then you can search by year and page number. So in this case, we're going to search a typical example. So we're going to search for the serial and page number, and we already know that that is now 17. We put in a hyphen and a 10. It's really important how you structure your search in your attribute search in the HLRV. We'll then search for that attribute, and we get one result. And there's Cornelius Regan's grant. I'll click X here. And now I'm going to show you how to search for the an old system deed, that is the deed between Veitch and Stockbridge. I'm going to clear my search again by clicking on the icon, go back into old system records. We need to search those indexes. Now, the General Register of Deeds has two main indexes. There's the vendors index and the purchasers index. There's two vendors indexes. One is for Mac and Mac. Now, just keep in mind, though, that only the vendors index is complete for those early years. The purchasers index only covers from 1896 onwards. So in those first years of old system deeds, you're only going to be able to search through the vendors index. Click on the vendors index here, and we're going to search by a surname. Click on attribute, and in the search by, we're going to search by surname initial. Now, this is one of the frustrating parts of HLRV. Sometimes it's hard to know how to structure the attribute. In the case of the General Register of Deeds, you need to search by the first two letters of your surname, VE for Veitch. And this is in that step-by-step guide that, that you'll be able to access. And so we'll hit the search button there and we get 57 results. So that's 57 indexes where the vendor's surname starts with VE. We need to, I just want to flag too that sometimes these indexes cover multiple years, the years overlap. So for example, 1884 appears in two indexes. So just check that you've covered everything if you can't find the person in the index that you're looking for. Scroll down here, and I want to go to page two because I know that is where the index appears for Veitch. And this is covering the time period where after 1857 to 64, it's an 8-page index. I'm going to click on that icon. And Veitch is actually appearing on the very first page here, Thomas Veitch selling to James Stockbridge. And there's the all important book and number 79661. This tells us that it's, yes, the land we're after in Upper Paddington. And you'll notice here too that he's also sold to a Henry Baker and Henry Pickering. And those names might sound familiar to you because they're appearing on that old system title deed as James Stockbridge's neighbours. So this is obviously a subdivision. So we'll click on the X here and we're going to go back up to the top and click on the icon to clear the search and then set up a search for the that title deed. Go into old system registers and we're going to search the General Register of Deeds. And we click on attribute and we've only got one attribute to search by and that is the book and number 79-661. We search and we get one result and it's the 4-page title deed. So that's how you go about searching those two data sets. I hope this has given you some confidence and I hope that whilst the HLRV can be a bit tricky to search, our help guides over the course of these 4 webinar series will assist you in getting over some of those early hurdles. And I hope you stay tuned for the next session, session 3 with my colleague, Michael, who'll be taking you through the primary application documents that are available on the HLRV and also finding Torrens title deeds on this database. All the best with your searching and bye for now.